Progress is not a linear path, and over thousands of years, civilizations have risen and fallen. The ancient world was not isolated. They interacted, intermarried, and traded with one another, both in goods and ideals. In times of antiquity, Kemet was the light of the world. Sometimes their culture was exported or adopted by others. Other times they were conquered and co-opted by invaders. But the one constant in history is that cultures have built upon each other's knowledge and achievements. And as new civilizations are born, older civilizations are lost.
Spacecraft, and they walked, and they named the beast of the sea and the animals of the land.
Heavens.
And man in his blackness did walk the earth, making medicine.
Medicine?
They discovered time. These were all black people, got down! Wait till the brothers hear this!
Funa!
I'm gonna get this book out of here, baby! This tells me real tea!
Funa,
check this
Funa.
Out!
What
you mean, Jack? Look at this here. Black people discovered them, started the music and the brain surgery back in the year 3 BC.
Yes, of course, Bruno.
Man, they was getting down. This is it, brother.
Yes,
everybody gonna know about this. Listen, boy, we can change the history. Civilization will be changed.
By all means.
Yeah, this is gonna be it.
Get the bulldozers. There's nothing here.
But.
Shut up. Good heavens, time for tea, eh?
What?
The history of pre-dynastic Egypt and the movement of African tribes drawn to the Nile dates back to the end of the last ice age. Around the same time, the ice sheets began to melt. The lush tropical jungle that covered northern Africa began to dry up.
We went there to visit a beautifully painted prehistoric cave that was discovered in that region just discovered in 2007. It has on the ceiling very beautiful prehistoric rock art depicting the people who lived there and their raising of cattle and various domestic scenes and that sort of thing.
We're talking about black Africans.
Yes.
Over thousands of years, it became the Sahara Desert. There were migrations east, and many tribes settled on the banks of the Nile, along with tribes from the south. The White Nile begins in Tanzania and flows northward until it reaches Sudan, where it converges with the Blue Nile. The Blue Nile begins near Lake Tana in Ethiopia. Like the Nile, These ancient African tribes have been migrating from the south following the flow of the river northward since the Neolithic period.
The Napta Playa find was announced by CNN as the Stonehenge of the Sahara. And it's a fascinating site. It does have megaliths. And however, the calendar circle that got a lot of attention is composed of smaller stones that come up to about your knee, but that forms a very interesting calendar circle, which has astronomical meaning, and that calendar circle is in a complex of megalithic large stone structures and alignments as well.
Mm-hmm. Now, do we know anything at all about the people who created these structures?
Yes, we know they were black African people. Their remains are studied anthropologically, and they were the people inhabiting the region of the time.
Ancient Nubia and ancient Egypt share roots, common cultural roots, in Northeast Africa, in the Sahara, and along the Nile Valley. The ancient Egyptians and the ancient Nubians can both be described, especially in the earlier periods, as being descendants of Northeast African indigenous populations. As one writer said, all of these people are Africans, and I define Africans as people whose biological histories have emerged and their identities have emerged in Africa, and where any mixing that took place on African soil. The Egyptians did not come from any place else other than the Nile Valley. Their identities and any other ancestry that they may have had were all forged together in that space.
In those ancient times, Egyptians called themselves Remetch in Kermit, which means the people of the black land. Inscriptions refer to their origins being the land of Punt, which is present-day Somalia and northern Kenya. They point to these southeastern regions as being their ancestral homeland. Tseti was the earliest Great Nile Valley civilization and stretched from Nubia to Upper Kemet.
Yeah, that area became hyper-arid, extreme desert around 3400 BC.
Mm-hmm. But before that, the climate was different.
Yes, yes, it was more moderate. There were seasonal rains, and at the site that I studied, the ancient site that I studied, Napta Playa, even that would fill up seasonally as a seasonal lake bed. Call it a playa. Mm-hmm. The cattle cult and the Sirius and the cattle iconography was very important to them, as well as in ancient Egypt, which came later. So there are many elements, clearly, of the culture that was operating at Napta Playa in the earlier time that moved to the Nile Valley and became the ancient Egyptian dynastic civilization.
Tseti, which means land of the bow, predated Kemet by 500 years. Inner Africa was called Ta-Netjer, which translates to the land of gods. And an ancient site known as Jebel Barkal, located in modern-day Sudan, was thought to be the primordial birthplace of Amun, the god of gods. The ancient Nubians and Kemites looked to this sacred mound with a great reverence, as it was considered to be the perennial source of fertility as well as divine kingship. The Kemites took regular pilgrimages into the heart of Nubia to honor Amun and pay homage to the creator spirit. The religious and cultural ties of Kemet and Nubia run deep, so in 747 BC, when the Libyans occupied Kemet, Nubians from the kingdom of Kush marched north to restore law and order. Kemet was weak from being invaded repeatedly by the nomads. But when the Kushites arrived, It wasn't to ravage or destroy. They saw this as an opportunity to seize power and restore Kemet to its former glory. The Kushites spent a considerable amount of time rebuilding the great monuments and temples. This differs greatly from the Libyans and other Asiatic invaders who came to pillage and plunder. The Kushite pharaohs built columned temples with pylon gateways and added to the great Amun temple complex of Karnak. They also took the Old Kingdom's religious text and transferred them into stone for better preservation. An example of this is the Shabaka stone, named after the Nubian king who had it inscribed. On the stone, Shabaka added, "I found the writings of the ancients damaged, and I restored it better than it was."
Beliefs that centered on this great sandstone mountain, Jebel Barkal. For centuries, it had been regarded as the mythical mound of creation. The mound from which Egypt's great creator god, Amun, was born.
Here is the holy mountain. This is where the god lived in his primeval form.
Dr. Tim Kendall has spent almost 30 years working at the site.
Being at the southern limit of the empire, it was where the Nile began, where fertility began, and so it had to be the place where creation began. So this was they imagined this as the birthplace of the god Amun.
As the Kushite kings gained increasing military power, they also claimed Egypt for themselves. So when King Pi led a Kushite invasion of Egypt in 747 BC, he didn't plunder or destroy, but restored and rebuilt and founded Egypt's 25th dynasty.
The irony is that he's conquering Egypt to put everything right, I suppose.
So it's all such a cycle of rebirth, regrowth, redevelopment, and the Kushite kings are really kind of tapping into that ancient power source and just sort of giving it back to the Egyptians.
It's like starting time all over again and doing it right.
So they had that same sense of history and continuity as the Egyptians. They are the natural successors of the 18th dynasty kings.
The Greeks adopted much from the ancient Kemites, including architecture, medicine, chemistry, and philosophy. The philosophers of classical Greece, such as Pythagoras, Socrates, and Plato, were all initiated into the ancient mystery schools where they received their formal education. It should be noted that by the time Greece had developed into a nation-state, Kemet's pharaonic period had already been thriving for nearly 2,500 years.
If you read what the Greeks said, not what we think, but if you read what the Greeks said, they said they got everything from Egypt. Now, when did we come up with the idea that the Greeks created everything from scratch? Well, believe it or not, it happened in the 18th and 19th century. It was decided that it was just not appropriate for all this knowledge to come from an African country.
Since the beginning, populations in Kemet have mixed and intermingled, sharing cultures and traditions. The Mediterranean was a highway for commerce, transporting knowledge, spices, and raw materials. Kemet was the most revered in the ancient world, and Lower Kemet in particular was in constant contact with the Levant. Over thousands of years of migrations and invasions from Asiatic and European powers created a melting pot of ethnic variation. Indeed, the Islamic expansion into Africa in the 6th century AD and the migrations that followed contributed to this admixture. Arabic soon became the dominant language, but Coptic, which is a liturgical offshoot of ancient Egyptian, managed to survive within the Coptic Church. racist attitudes towards Black Africans are quite common within mainstream Egyptology and the connection modern Ethiopian, Eritrean, Somali, and Sudanese populations had with ancient Kemet has been minimized and ignored. In 2008, National Geographic published an article entitled "The Black Pharaohs, Conquerors of Ancient Egypt." This title is misleading at best. It draws on the Western world's reductionist ideology on race and identity. It subtly suggests that all other pharaohs were of non-black origin. A more appropriate title would be the Kushite pharaohs, as this is how they would be identified in the ancient times. However, you would never hear the term white pharaohs. This is because Egyptologists have always attempted to normalize whiteness in Kemet, while at the same time obscuring blackness. During an interview on BBC News Africa, Dr. Zahai Hawass illustrates Egyptology's reluctance to acknowledge Black African presence in ancient Egypt.
When asked about the ethnicity of the ancient Egyptians, he describes them as being uniquely Egyptian.
You cannot make any test. There are some studies to see that the shape of the skull could be looks like African, but still you will never put a final decision about the origin of the ancient Egyptian at all, because you need really to make a very comprehensive study by DNA, and this will take long time.
So how African the ancient Egyptians were still remains a matter of debate for some, even if UNESCO scholars now say the matter is settled and that the pharaohs and their people must be placed firmly within the Black African context.
In the days of antiquity, the Greeks, named for black and brown-skinned Africans, was Ethiopian, which translates to burnt face. The Greeks took great liberty to acknowledge the greatness of the Nile Valley civilizations and the regal qualities and character of the ancient Ethiopians.
The ancient Egyptian civilization was a black civilization, and ancient Egyptians were black according to the Greek scholars and the Roman scholars. Ancient Egypt became white only in the 19th century and in the 20th century. White supremacy argues that blacks are inferior than white intellectually. White supremacy had one dilemma. They had this dilemma: ancient Egyptian was black. So if blacks are inferior intellectually and are incapable of building a civilization, how come the ancient Egyptians built a civilization? Seligman found the solution for this dilemma. He came up with a theory called the Hamite theory. He separated the blacks who built a civilization in Egypt and Ethiopia from the rest of the black race, and he called them brown-skinned whites, or the Hamites. And since that time, white scholarship says that ancient Egypt is white.
In antiquity, the dark hue of the Ethiopian was not taboo, and the fairer hue of the Greek or Roman did not denote purity. When Rome fell by the hands of the barbarians from the north, their empire entered into a 500-year dark age. In September 476 AD, the last Roman emperor, Romulus Augustulus, was deposed by a Germanic prince named Otto Vacar. Germanic tribes had undergone massive technological, social, and economic progress after four centuries of subjugation under the Roman Empire. They used this edge to bring Rome to its knees. During this period, written sources were few and far between, and a lot of the ancient knowledge was lost and destroyed by the Goths, Vandals, and Anglo-Saxons. The barbarians laid waste to the Great Republic during their numerous sackings of Rome. African influence was common during the European Dark Ages, and non-Muslim Moors held position of power and prestige within the royal monarchy. Muslim Moors conquered parts of Italy, Spain, and Portugal, and ruled over 700 years before finally being expelled. During their reign, they reintroduced Europeans to the lost philosophies of the Greeks, which Moors had preserved over the centuries. For the first time in recorded history, Northern Europeans were introduced to the mystical arts and high sciences by way of the Greeks, by way of the ancient Kemites. This reintroduction of ancient knowledge is what lit the fuse to the European Age of Enlightenment and gave birth to Western civilization as we know it. They say you don't know where you are going if you don't know where you have been. Knowledge of self is critical for all and empowers those who possess it. It illustrates the journey of one's ancestors and puts cultural identity into proper historical context.
I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, Rock, that when people of African ancestry are exposed to the truths that have been historically hidden away from us, it changes the way we see ourselves. It increases our level of respect for ourselves and those who look like us. It changes everything. Because if you don't know who you are, if you don't understand the historical foundation upon which you stand, then you will believe the lies that you are less than, that you're the N-word, you're the B-word, and you won't attempt to become better. Telling our children the historical truth makes a difference in the souls of the children who hear that truth. Black children and white children, makes a difference, and it changes the trajectory of their lives. I've seen the effect that talking to our children specifically about their history has on them. Their eyes widen, and they see the potential within them.
Although the origins of Kemet have been hidden from the world, this lost culture remains embedded within the DNA of the African diaspora, and the cultural continuity is still visible throughout the motherland. Within the last 50 years, there have been a host of academics that are challenging the status quo and setting the record straight.
Great thinkers like Cheikh Anta Diop from Senegal, the late Senegalese professor. Yes, yes, you know, he should be known. You know, he was a polymath, one of the greatest minds of the 20th century. You see students now at Oxford University saying we want African history to be taught because it's part of world history. African history is part of the global narrative. It's not just something that's just relevant to you if you are of African origin. You know, it is absolutely for everybody. So this is what I'm very keen to be part of, is reconstructing African history from an African perspective, putting the African intelligentsia center stage.
Over the years, the truth has slowly begun to emerge, and many schools of thought have developed within the conscious community.
You cannot enslave a mind that knows itself, that values itself, that understands itself.
It is up to us to teach our children the rich and diverse history of melanated peoples across the globe. We must remember great African warriors such as Hannibal of Carthage and Queen Amenarinus of Nubia, both of which defeated the mighty Roman Empire. And Memnon, the king of Ethiopia, who fought in the Trojan War, was known to be one of the greatest warriors in Greek mythology. We must revive great African kings, such as King Pi, the Kushite pharaoh and founder of the 25th dynasty of Egypt, and Mansa Musa, the ninth Mansa of the Mali Empire and wealthiest man in world history. Most importantly, we must reclaim our classical African civilization, Egypt, affectionately known as Kemet. We live in the age of information, and it is time we pierce the veil of ignorance and retrace our steps across the sands of time.
Pacific.
Emperor. Direct descent from Solomon and the Queen of Sheba. He is the King of Kings, the Lion of Judah. The name Haile Selassie means power of the Trinity.
Educate yourselves of Africa. To liberate yourself, Africa. Keep your heads up high. No more will we cry. Hey. Our history that they stole, Africa. Is written in our souls, Africa. Oldest nation on this earth. Know just what you're worth. Well, well, ships that sail to distant places robbed us of our rights and words. History says that you've betrayed us, talking of the gods you serve. Hear the rumbling in the sky, tears that our forefathers cry. And today we're still in chains, take the shackle from our mind. Keep your heads up high, no more will we cry. Africa, and claim it as their own, Africa. But now we must stand tall to break down all these walls. Well, well, our children must be taught of Africa, the science and the arts of Africa. Educate yourselves, Africa. To liberate yourselves, Africa. Keep your heads up high. No more will we cry. Beautiful art thou, Africa. A legend of the bow, Africa.